got to get on to what's one of the most important things we do here. And we're giving a, I wouldn't call it an award, but paying a tribute to somebody that gave all. And it's incredible that he's got into the support of all of his family here. And we certainly appreciate each and every one of you coming. So, but the make that presentation is going to be Guy Radowski and Ed Mitchell. So if you guys come up, and Ed, you can just hold a minute, we'll get Guy here first.
I completed about half of the 9-month Special Forces Medical Specialist Program at Fort Bragg. I'd gotten in some serious trouble and was told to report to the CO's office. Waiting for me in the office were 3 Green Berets, a captain, lieutenant colonel, and the first sergeant. The first sergeant, having served multiple tours in Vietnam and remote special forces camps, was the embodiment of a hardcore Green Beret. As you can imagine, he was a zero tolerance kind of guy. The 3 of them took turns ripping me a new one, issued me an Article 15, reduced my rank by 2 grades, kicked me out of special forces. Finally, the first sergeant leaned in close to me and with a satanic grin ended this one-sided conversation.
Soldier, you're going to Vietnam.
That's how I became a member of Alpha Company. I proudly served as a field medic in Vietnam in 1970 with the men of Alpha Company. 2nd Battalion, 501st Infantry. Drive on. Can I get a drive on, please?
Drive on.
General Mitchell frequently reminds us that those we lost gave us the gift of another day. I want to elaborate on the meaning of this profound concept by combining ideas from an inspirational presentation made by pilot Brian Shull, S-H-U-L. He was the main speaker at a dinner fundraiser I attended recently for the Champaign Aviation Museum in Urbana, Ohio. This nonprofit, all-volunteer organization restores the flying condition World War II aircraft. Their passion is to educate the public about the experiences of past generations and to honor the crew members who flew these aircraft into combat, thereby keeping alive their gift of another day. The atmosphere at this dinner fundraiser was vibrant with pride and patriotism, and it was a welcoming tribute to all veterans and their families. Brian Shull, who flew missions for the CIA, was shot down in Vietnam along the Cambodian border. He was rescued, but so badly burned and required so many major operations. He was told he'd never fly again, and he was lucky to be alive. Although disfigured from scar tissue and missing fingers in his left hand, he returned to flying fighter jets. And against all odds, he was chosen as one of 93 pilots to ever fly missions in the SR-71A Blackbird spy plane, the world's fastest, highest flying jet, It could fly coast to coast in 64 minutes, altitude above 80,000 feet, and cruising at 2,000 miles an hour. Brian Shule delivered a clear and simple message. Life is short. Find your passion, follow your dream. In January of 2017, I had an appointment with a VA psychiatrist. It was not court ordered. I requested this appointment because in August of 2016, I experienced a full-blown flashback while I was inside an MRI tunnel. The flashback was triggered by the two alternating sounds the scanner makes, which are similar to a 50 caliber machine gun and a Cobra gunship mini cannon. Over the years, I learned to manage and live with flashbacks, but this one blindsided me and was intensely vivid with elements of dissociation from reality, meaning I was no longer in Lansing, Michigan, I was back in Vietnam. So for the first time, I went to the VA, did all the necessary paperwork, and had my appointment with the psychiatrist. The psychiatrist asked me to tell him in my own words about the traumatic events I experienced in Vietnam. I explained to him that in 2010 I began writing fact-based war stories, and I made a list of 10 of the most violent experiences I had in Vietnam. I told him how I had to watch helplessly as life turned to death, and there was little time for grief. He said, "You have to pick one story. I want you to pick the worst one. The one that disturbed you the most." And I thought, and then I proceeded to tell him what I experienced on May 20th, 1970. All gave some gave all. May 20th, 1970, southwest of Phu Bai, Republic of Vietnam. This story is based on events described in my letters from Vietnam and my recall details as a first responder. Tactical background information was provided by Brigadier General James Edwin Mitchell, U.S. Army retired. On May 17th, the 101st Airborne Division issued a serious threat warning of a possible NVA attack on the Phu Bai Combat Base to honor the anniversary of Ho Chi Minh's birthday. On May 18th, Alpha Company, commanded by Captain James E. Mitchell, air assault in southwest of Phu Bai to carry out a screening operation. Our mission was counter-reconnaissance, to locate and disrupt enemy forces that might attempt to infiltrate the area. I was assigned a 3rd platoon of Alpha Company as a field medic. It was my first combat mission. I was apprehensive, but a year of training, including special forces, survival, SF medic training, gave me confidence. At nightfall on May 19th, 3rd platoon established defensive positions on a knoll covered with high grass. There was no imminent threat reported that night, so we maintained watch with 2-hour exterior guard shifts at each position. Between 0100 and 0300 hours on May 20th, an explosion rocked the hilltop. Believing we were under attack, our position opened fire as frantic screams came from the southwest sector of our perimeter. "They're out there. Goofs. Medic. Medic." I started low crawling through the high grass, dragging my medical bag and M16 toward the wounded soldier. Explosion, gunfire screaming, adrenaline surging, my heart pounding. Suddenly there was movement on my left and I froze. Staff Sergeant Bob Nickel was advancing beside me, scanning for the enemy. As we reached the horrific scene, the first soldier was found sitting up, pointing and yelling, "They're out there. Help me, my leg." His left leg was broken. 3 feet away, Sergeant Tony Ward lied dead, and in the middle was PFC Roy Carter, fighting to stay alive, unconscious but breathing. The hissing sound of sucking chest wounds and the stench of explosives and the metallic scent of Carter's blood are unwelcome flashbacks. The soldier with the broken leg was terrified, and his constant screaming was giving away our position. So I stoned him out on morphine. Kneeling over Carter, I was desperate, trying to seal the puncture holes in his chest. So many holes, oozing blood more than I could contain. Tony Ward's body was within reach next to Carter, lying face up and completely silent, his lifeless eyes watching me. It was less than 2 days ago that I first met Roy Carter and Tony Ward. We shared stories about home, and I got the impression they were friends. Artillery support provided illumination, and the gunfire stopped. There was no enemy. Incredibly, there was no enemy anywhere. The rhythmic womp-womp sound of the fast-approaching medevac offered me hope. Carter was fatally wounded, but still breathing. We carried the three soldiers to the chopper. Governing Roy Carter's blood, I stood in disbelief, watching the medevac lift off. After the adrenaline fades, haunting images of violence and death, he is your soul. The epilogue, Roy Carter and Tony Ward sacrificed their lives after less than 3 weeks of service in Vietnam. Their deaths are listed as non-hostile ground casualty from an apparent accidental grenade explosion. No one knows how or why this happened. From February through July of 1970, Alpha Company, 2nd 501st, lost 25 gallant men and had countless wounded. To cope with the many experiences of brutal combat and death, in Vietnam, I became emotionally detached and learned to suppress these traumatic events that they would forever haunt my subconscious. Not one of us who survived emerged the same as we arrived. The images of killing, dying, and suffering indelibly marked us all. That's a quote from Joseph Galloway, who was a war correspondent in Vietnam. That's from the front lines of the Battle of the Drang, November 1965. So I chose this story for the psychiatrist for 3 reasons. It was the most painful. Understand that I arrived in Vietnam only 3 weeks prior, the same as Tony and Roy. I wasn't yet numb to the suffering and dying. I was still able to feel emotional pain. It was the most intimate because I just met Tony and Roy. On the 18th, we shared a connection. I felt a bond with two soldier brothers. I even wrote a home about this meeting in my first letter from Vietnam. It was certainly one of the most tragic because of the unanswered questions and the circumstances surrounding their deaths. Book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verse 8. And the Lord spoke, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" Then a voice was heard, "I will go, send me." Tony is buried in Floral Memory Gardens, Albany, Georgia. Roy is buried in Springbank Cemetery, Yellow Bud, Ohio. I never think of Tony without thinking of Roy. Life is short and life is uncertain. Tony and Roy gave us the gift of another day. The psychiatrist recommended that I keep writing about my Vietnam experiences, that writing would help me more than anything he could offer. Writing personal stories has allowed me to portray combat from the human viewpoint as well as the brotherhood we share. We band of brothers, for he that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother. That's William Shakespeare, Henry V. Sebastian Junger, it's spelled J-U-N-G-E-R, is an American journalist, anthropologist, and author who has written extensively about war and its effects on soldiers. Here are some of his reflections on brotherhood. Returning home from war, soldiers feel painful absence. They don't miss war, the adrenaline rush of combat. They miss the brotherhood and the intense connection to other men. Brotherhood is a mutual agreement that you put the safety of the group above your own. You ignore all differences, and soldiers bond with salt-of-the-earth men that you know will have your back. Brotherhood brings out the best in us. You fight for each other, and you never leave a fallen comrade. Brotherhood provides leadership and mentoring, helping boys become men. As many of us witness in Vietnam, brotherhood can inspire unprecedented acts of loyalty and courage, including the ultimate sacrifice. The lives of our brothers, Tony and Roy, were cut short, and the circumstances of their deaths remains uncertain. However, they both discovered their dreams and their passions. For Tony, it was motorcycles, cars, drag racing. For Roy, it was agriculture, farming, and livestock 4-H. Yet they never lived long enough to fulfill their dreams. They never had the opportunity of fatherhood, to be a mentor, a coach, own a business, or to be a grandfather. Or to be with us today as part of the Alpha Avengers Brotherhood. Tony and Roy are among the 58,276 warriors we lost in Vietnam. Their sacrifice gives us a gift every day. All they ask in return is that we walk for them, speak for them, and always remember their gift to us. To safeguard that we never take life and the privileges we enjoy for granted, we must remind ourselves and remind each other. Our freedom stands tall on the shoulders of their sacrifice. The legacy of our fallen heroes is meant to inspire us to find our passion and follow our dreams. Welcome each new day in their honor by saluting them and their gift to us, knowing that life is short and life is uncertain, knowing that those we've lost gave us the gift of another day. Thank you. Drive on, brothers.